Hi everyone. Today in this video we are going to discuss about metformin. How this drug acts as antidiabetic agent, what is the mechanism, side effects, precautions and drug interactions of metformin we will discuss in this video. What is this drug metformin? Metformin is chemically belongs to the class of biguanides. We have another drug within this category, fenformin, which is withdrawn from the market. So nowadays only metformin is available. This metformin is having some unique action compared with other antidiabetic agents. This drug is going to increase the insulin sensitivity, but at the same time this drug is not going to increase the insulin secretion. We know if you have the other antidiabetic agents such as sulfonylureas, which are going to increase the insulin release. But here metformin is not releasing the insulin, but it is going to increase the sensitivity of the insulin. This is one of the important requirements to control the type 2 diabetes. That's why metformin is the first drug that is indicated to treat type 2 diabetes mellitus. Apart from this, metformin also shows some weight loss. It reduces the body weight. Other drugs like sulfonylureas are going to increase the weight, resulting in the weight gain. But this drug is going to reduce the body weight to some extent. That's why this drug is preferred in the obese patients who are suffering with type 2 diabetes mellitus. So today in this video, we are going to discuss about this metformin. What is the structure of metformin? So this is the simple structure of metformin. And we have already discussed that this drug chemically belongs to the biguanides. Biguanide is a combination of two guanidine moieties. So this is the biguanide structure, and to this on the nitrogen two methyl groups are present. So metformin is a biguanide derivative. Now on the nitrogen two methyl groups are there. So this is NN dimethyl biguanide. So that is the simple structure of metformin. Now let us see how this metformin acts. Metformin shows important activity on the three important organs. First one is the liver. From the liver, glucose can be produced, which results in the increased blood glucose levels. So this hepatic glucose production is going to be blocked by metformin. Similarly, at the intestine, glucose can be absorbed through the glucose transporters. So metformin is also reducing the carbohydrate absorption, thereby glucose absorption. And third target is the muscle. Glucose can be taken into the muscle. So this uptake of glucose into the skeletal muscle is going to be stimulated by metformin. In this way, metformin reduces the blood glucose levels and increases the glucose uptake into the skeletal muscle. Among these, the action of metformin on the liver is mainly responsible for glycemic control of the drug. So suppose this is the liver cell. On this liver, glucagon can act. Now glucagon is one of the mediator which is going to increase the blood glucose levels. It can act on the glucagon receptors expressed on the hepatic cells. These receptors are G protein coupled receptors. When this glucagon binds to these G protein coupled receptors, they will activate adenylyl cyclase system. Now this adenylyl cyclase can convert the ATP into cyclic AMP. This cyclic AMP is an important secondary messenger which can activate the protein kinase A, which are the phosphorylating enzymes, which can activate the so many types of enzymes responsible for increased glucose production. For instance, they can activate one of the enzyme, glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, which is responsible for the glycogenolysis, the breakdown of the glycogen into the glucose. Similarly, they can also increase the gluconeogenesis. In this way, glucagon increase the blood glucose levels. Another target within the liver is the mitochondria. Within the mitochondria, oxidative phosphorylation will take place, and one of the mediator NADH can be converted into ATP by the complex 1 reactions. In this way, mitochondria produce ATP by increased glucose levels within the blood. Now, metformin can act on these targets to control the glucose levels. This metformin can enter into the hepatic cells through the OCT1. Organic cation transporter 1. Now this metformin can enter into the hepatocytes and it can act on this complex 1 reactions. such that it inhibits the production of ATP. Now, because of this, ATP levels are reduced, and when the ATP levels are reduced, it results in increased AMP levels. In this way, within the hepatocytes, the ratio of AMP to the ADP is going to be increased, as well as the ratio of ADP to the ADP is also increased. Now, these raised levels of AMP can inhibit the adenylyl cyclase system, thereby they can inhibit the glucagon-related activity. Similarly, this increased AMP levels can also activate another enzyme, AMPK, AMP-dependent protein kinase enzyme, which is again responsible for control of glucose production within the hepatocytes. And third target is to control the FBPase enzyme. This is the fructose 1,6 biphosphatase enzyme, which is required for gluconeogenesis. And when this enzyme is going to be inhibited, the glucose production by the hepatocytes is going to be reduced. By all of these actions, metformin can control the glucose levels. And many of these actions just resembling the insulin activity. So metformin is going to increase the insulin sensitivity, thereby to reduce the hepatic glucose production. What are the precautions? One of the important precautions of metformin is that this drug can produce lactic acidosis. The lactic acid levels are excessively increased within the blood, resulting in the lactic acidosis. Normally, the lactic acid levels are ranging from 0.5 to 1 millimoles per liter. But when this metformin is used, the lactate levels may be increased greater than 5 millimoles per liter. And this drug can also increase the ratio between the lactate to the pyruvate. So lactate levels are increased and pyruvate levels are reduced, which resembles some anaerobic condition. And even the anionic gap acidosis also increased because of the increased lactic acid levels. So this is one of the important precautions that should be carefully monitored. And when this lactic acidosis is going to be developed, we can observe few of the symptoms such as myalgia, muscle pain, abdominal pain, malaise, some feeling of weakness, somnolence, increased sleepiness, diarrhea, headache, anorexia, loss of appetite, and hypotension. Along with this, lactic acidosis can also precipitate bronchospasm and bradycardia. So care should be taken to monitor any of these symptoms, and lactic acid level should be checked when this drug is prescribed for chronic use. And sometimes this lactic acidosis is also increased with other factors. Pyruvate is one of the important mediator which can be converted into oxaloacetate by pyruvate carboxylase enzyme. Then this oxaloacetate is responsible for the gluconeogenesis. Similarly, pyruvate can also be converted into lactate by another enzyme, lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. Now here, metformin can act on these two steps. Metformin can inhibit this pyruvate carboxylase enzyme such that it can inhibit the formation of oxaloacetate and gluconeogenesis. And it can also increase the NADH levels by inhibition of the electron transport chain complex 1 reactions. And this NADH acts as a cofactor for LDH, so that metformin can increase the conversion of pyruvate to the lactate. In this way, metformin can increase the lactate levels, resulting in the lactic acidosis. But sometimes, other factors can also increase the lactic acidosis when they are coexist with metformin. For instance, iodinated contrast agents can increase the lactic acidosis. Otherwise, excessive alcohol intake can also increase the lactic acidosis. And recent surgery, after the surgery, there may be a development of lactic acid levels, resulting in the lactic acidosis. Similarly, few of the disorders like congestive heart failure, which produce the hypoxia, and hepatic impairment, which reduce the lactic acid uptake, and even the age greater than 65 years, all these factors can increase the lactic acidosis. And these factors may increase the lactic acidosis that is produced by metformin. Another important precaution is that metformin excretion through the kidneys. Metformin is excreted unchanged through the kidneys. So if a patient is having any renal impairment, it results in the accumulation of metformin levels within the blood, resulting in the lactic acidosis. So renal functionality should be checked when this drug is used for prolonged period. Particularly estimated glomerular filtration rate is monitored, which is normally having a range greater than 90 ml per minute per 1.73 square mm of body surface area. But when this eGFR levels are less than 30 ml per minute per 1.73 square mm of body surface area, then metformin is contraindicated because it is not excreted properly and its levels are excessively increased, resulting in lactic acidosis. So in the renally impaired patients, the dose of the metformin should be reduced, and in the severe renal impairment, this drug should be contraindicated. We have seen that metformin is going to increase the insulin sensitivity. Since this drug is not secreting the insulin, so this drug is less likely to produce hypoglycemia. But when this drug is given with other conditions such as malnutrition or strenuous exercise in the patients, in case of alcohol intoxication, adrenal insufficiency, otherwise along with other antidiabetic agents such as sulfonylureas, if any of these factors are present, they may increase the hypoglycemic effect produced by metformin. Metformin can reduce the absorption of vitamin B12, so it may increase the vitamin B12 deficiency. It may not result in the anemia, but the levels of vitamin B12 are reduced in presence of metformin. Now let us see the drug interactions of metformin. Few of the drugs like estrazolamide, which is a diuretic, and jonisamide, which is an anti-epileptic agent, topiramate, again it's an anti-epileptic agent. These drugs are going to inhibit the carbonic anhydrase activity. This carbonic anhydrase is required to combine water and carbon dioxide into the carbonic acid, or vice versa. Now, when this enzyme is going to be inhibited, it results in the increased bicarbonate excretion. And when this bicarbonate is excreted, it results in the increased acid levels within the body, resulting in metabolic acidosis. Now, these drugs produce metabolic acidosis, and when these drugs are given along with metformin, it further increases the acid levels, resulting in lactic acidosis. Similarly, few of the drugs like corticosteroids, thiazide diuretics, oral contraceptives, phenytoin, and thyroid agents, all these drugs are going to increase the glucose levels, resulting in hyperglycemia. So when these drugs are given along with metformin, it may result in the loss of glycemic control of metformin. So when this metformin is given with these drugs, the activity of metformin is reduced because of hyperglycemic effect of these drugs. What are the side effects? The important side effects of metformin mainly include diarrhea, indigestion, flatulence, nausea, headache, lack of energy, dizziness, flushing, taste disturbances, some metallic disturbances can be observed, palpitations, increased awareness of heartbeat, this may be because of decreased glucose levels, and some chills, sweating can be observed. Along with these side effects, and decreased appetite and weight loss can also be observed. These are the common side effects produced by metformin, but apart from these side effects, if any side effects related to the lactic acidosis, they should be carefully monitored, which may result in hypotension, bradycardia, and muscle weakness in the patients. How it is given? This drug is given as a tablet form as well as extended release tablet. It's also available as solution, and the strengths may be variable based on the dosage form. It is available at 500 mg, 850 mg and 1000 mg strengths. The dose of metformin should be individualized. With the normal tablet of the metformin, the initial dose is given at 500 mg twice daily, otherwise 850 mg once daily. Initially, the glycemic control may not be achieved, so the dose should be increased, and the increment should be done after 1 week of the treatment at a rate of 500 mg or 850 mg. So this is the dosing for the immediate release tablet. But in case of extended release tablets, the dose is somewhat different. The initial dose is 500 mg once daily, And again, the increments can be given after 1 week of treatment at a rate of 500 mg. So that's about this metformin. Metformin is a biguanide which increases the insulin sensitivity as well as reduce the body weight, but it is not secreting the insulin. This drug is mainly inhibiting the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase A activation. This pathway, which is stimulated by glucagon, is inhibited by metformin. This drug can enter into the hepatocytes through the OCT1, organic cation transporter 1, and it can inhibit the respiratory chain complex 1 reactions, thereby it reduces the conversion of NADH into ATP. And when the ATP levels are reduced, it increases the AMP levels, which inhibits glucagon-mediated protein kinase A activation. The raised AMP levels can also stimulate the AMPK, resulting in the more glycemic control, and it can also inhibit the FBPase enzyme, fructose 1,6 biphosphatase enzyme, thereby it reduces the gluconeogenesis. And when this drug is given, precaution should be taken to control the lactic acidosis, because this drug can increase the lactic acid levels, which may result in the myalgia, muscle weakness, fatigue. And this drug should be carefully given with other drugs which are going to inhibit the carbonic anhydrase activity, which may result in the metabolic acidosis. The lactic acidosis produced by metformin may be increased by so many factors such as iodinated contrasting agents, excessive alcohol intake, post-surgical complications, age of the patient greater than 65 years, congestive heart failure, hepatic impairment, all these may increase the lactic acidosis. And the patients with renal impairment, the metformin is not excreted properly, which results in the increased metformin levels leading to lactic acidosis. And metformin is available at the different strengths, 500 mg, 850 mg, 1000 mg. The maximum dose is 2000 mg per day. In the immediate release tablets, the initial dose is 500 mg twice daily or 850 mg once daily. The increments can be given after 1 week of the treatment at rate of 500 mg or 850 mg. In case of extended release tablets, the initial dose is 500 mg once daily with increments of 500 mg after 1 week of the treatment. But again, the dose should be individualized based on the conditions of the patient and renal functionality. So that's for today. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel. Share this video with your friends. Post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.